yet uncovered recently in Italy. And he's been flown around the world to speak about his discoveries and adventures in art history, his work in inter-religious understanding. He's spoken at the Knesset in Israel, the Presidential Palace of Italy, the Capitol Hill Museum of Rome, and that was just on one weekend. Page two. And this is a brief biography. I could go on and on, but I won't. But I do want to tell you some other things about Roy. He's spoken at many places, a special live broadcast at the 92nd Street Y in New York City. He's spoken at book festivals from San Diego to Sicily, and many times inside the Sistine Chapel itself. He's consulted regularly by art historians, museums, curators, artists, and if any of you have read Dan Brown's book, if you read any of Dan Brown's books, you know the character of Robert Langdon. Well, he's a real-life Robert Langdon. So far, luckily, without any trail of murder victims. So a different kind of art. A few years ago, he discovered one of the lost masterpieces of Michelangelo, the actual original terracotta model for the Pietà. He's spoken to many members of the U.S. government in Washington. He's the private guy for Vice President Biden's family. He's helped Jeremy Irons, who played the role of one of the Borgia popes. He helped him in this subject, and his studies include many languages, Italian, American Sign Language, French, Italian Sign Language, Hebrew, and Latin, amongst others. He's delved into not only art history and religious history, Western civilization, theater and film, and when he learned of his Jewish heritage at a later age, he's also a passionate lecturer on Judaism and an eternal student of Torah, Talmud, and Kabbalah. He's seen all over Italian media discussing art, history, and religion, and he's been interviewed in virtually every country in the world. Some of the VIPs that he's taken on a tour of the Vatican, the Treasurer General of the U.S., General David Petraeus, Israeli Defense Force Military College, the Secretary of Agriculture, it could go on and on. And he also was the Judaic historical consultant for a film that was the first film to have its world premiere at the Vatican. He is the first religious Jew to be officially authorized to guide inside the Vatican. He's received a commendation from the Italian government for his work in popularizing Italian art history. And when in Rome, Roy does what very few Romans do. He's a constant fixture both in the Vatican and the Jewish Museum. Ladies and gentlemen, you're very lucky to be addressed by Mr. Roy Doliner.
They go to the mikveh, and they become full-fledged as we say in Latin, frumeim, fully religious Orthodox Jews who were brought up Catholic. And this is happening more and more all throughout southern Italy and Sicily. So in this story, this one man, he hears he might be Jewish, goes and checks the archives. Sure enough, his family was forcibly converted 500 years ago. And he starts studying, doesn't tell his wife, his family, nobody. And finally, after years of study, he's ready, he does giyur, he goes to the mikveh, he's so excited, he runs all the way home, and he bursts into the house, he says, wife, guess what? And he tells her the whole story, he says, today I converted, today I'm a Jew, we are now a new Jewish family. What do you think of that? And she says, with one day before Pesach, I'm going to kill you. Now we can talk. I feel like the first scene of Moby Dick up here. I'm going to get agoraphobia or whatever. Story of the Sistine Chapel, I will tell you, I was the biggest skeptic world. I thought my imagination was running away from me. I thought, no, this could not happen. As Tommy described to you, I was a VIP guide in the Vatican, and because of that, I was the first religious Jew ever to spend hours and hours inside the Sistine Chapel. Now, one thing you should know about my background is when I was living in New York City for a while, one of the languages I speak is sign language, American Sign Language for the Deaf. Everybody asks me when I do signing, because it's like a second language to me. They say that, we thought you were deaf, that's amazing. Were your parents deaf? And I said, no, they just didn't listen. But I was fluent in sign, I still am. And if you're fluent in sign language, you become an expert automatically in nonverbal communication. If I meet with a deaf person, I can have an entire conversation. We can sit like this with our hands folded. You don't need the hands. But with our faces, we can convey everything, and with body language, all of that. Because of that, I became the go-to interpreter in New York City for art history classes as a prerequisite or a requirement for people in the university. The deaf students love to pick art history because it's entirely visual. You have slides and you have to notice details that are visual, perfect for deaf students. So I was the go-to interpreter for NYU and Columbia and you name all the big universities in New York City. So I went from freshman first day to through postgraduate work in art history. And because of that, I could have had my degree in art history at least five times over. All these universities, I never got a degree in art history, which really twists the nose of people who don't like a non-Catholic or a non-Christian person working in art history. Because of that, I became so imbued with the history of art and learning the styles and the secrets of all the different artists. When you become an interpreter for art history, you have to become each artwork. I can't just talk about, let's say, the Mona Lisa. I have to become the Mona Lisa for the deaf students. And because of that, you have to be able to cold analyze a piece of art in record time. Normally, what would take a person days or weeks to analyze, you're interpreting. You're on the spot. You have to do it right then and there. Find out the salient parts, the focal points, and the hidden meaning. So it was like boot camp for somebody who would work in the Vatican Museums. I didn't know what was going to happen with my future, but this is all Hashem. This is exactly Hashem manipulated everything from start to finish about all of this. So when I walked into the Sistine Chapel and spent time there alone, the chapel ceiling was screaming at me visually. And I started immediately finding stuff. Said, I can't tell anybody, I'm imagining this. It can't be. But it was. I researched for many many years and found out it was all documented facts. What the Inquisition had done over the centuries is the Jewish thread connecting every advance in civilization from the Renaissance. They cut it out. And my self-appointed job is to weave it back in. When I take non-Jewish people, especially Catholics around the Vatican, I asked Vice President Biden's family. He wasn't there. They were all very happy about that. They said, Joe is such a bore. He doesn't like these things, but his family was great. I said, why are you going with me instead of one of the Catholic guides? You're all religious Catholics. And they said, we've heard about you, and we want 100% of the story, not 50% of the story. And that is so satisfying to me. It's a big Kiddush Hashem that people now know that if they don't get the Jewish part of the story, they're only getting half of the story. This has been going on for 500 years. So you'll come on this journey with me, and you'll see some of the Jewish secrets that I found inside the Vatican and inside the life of Michelangelo Buonarroti. Now, we'll go to the year 1475. And let me see. Maybe I'm not getting the right angle. There we go. No? I just turned off my angle.
Talk amongst yourselves.
Stand over here, this way I get to see you better. Now, in 1475, this man was born. This is Michelangelo Buonarroti. He is arguably the most famous Catholic artist in history. One of the most famous artists in history. When I lecture to student groups, they say, oh, he's one of the four turtles from the Ninja Turtles. Anyway. He's born in Caprese, which is a little town in Tuscany, not far from Florence. In the same year, 1475, there was a horrible incident that happened in northern Italy. A baby boy, a young boy, Simone, was found mutilated and killed. And the killer had broken a window and thrown the body in the cellar Jewish home or building. And they took all the leaders of the Jewish community, tortured them mercilessly for a long time, got faked or false confessions from them. And this was probably the first accusation of the blood libel in the history of Italy. So here's one detail from a wood engraving of the period, hand and it shows the Jews mutilating and squeezing the blood out of this young Catholic boy to make the matzahs. And this was the start of a horrible cycle of anti-Semitism, institutionalized anti-Semitism in Italy at the time. 1475, birth of Michelangelo, or as we call him, Michelangelo. And the blood libel of Trent in northern Italy. A third thing happened at that time. This building was commissioned by the Pope back then, and they started construction in 1475. This is the Pope who ordered it made. This is Pope, there we go. Oops. This is Pope Sixtus IV. And whenever he ordered a project, his name would be the adjective on it. It would be a Sistine project. For instance, any pope's name Paul, the Pauline. Pauline Church, the Pauline Chapel, the Pauline Wall, etc. Leo, Leonine, etc. Pope Sixtus, anything he commissions is Sistine, for his name Sixtus, and therefore the chapel that he ordered built became called later on the Sistine Chapel. Now, you won't make the same mistake that many visitors make. They come out of the whole tour of the Vatican, they go, our guy cheated us. We only saw the 16th chapel. We didn't see the other 15. So we have, by the way, do you mind if I digress? We have, by the way, amongst all the top guys in Rome, an annual competition, informal competition, for the stupidest tourist question of the year. Now, I can tell you this because I was born in the United States. People from the U.S. love winning competition. And they always get the top prize for the dumbest tourist joke. There was one right in the Vatican, in front of St. Peter's Basilica, and it was a Catholic from the United States who said, excuse me, how many centuries before Jesus did they build this building? It gets worse, don't worry. My favorite, why my favorite one? My favorite one was, there's a colossal statue of Moses made by Michelangelo in Rome, and the Italian guy brought it in and explained everything. He said, any questions? And one American, U.S. citizen raised his hand and said, yeah, how long did Moses have to pose? Part of being a guide. So now you know that Pope Sixtus IV commissioned the Sistine Chapel. He had a lot of so-called nephews. Now, to this day in the Italian language, there is no difference in the vocabulary between nephew and grandson. The Vatican said, this is how the language will remain, that a nephew could be either or. And so he had innumerable, quote-unquote, nephews. He gave them all fantastic wedding presents and gifts. Oh, you want Tuscany? Here's Tuscany for your wedding. Things like that. I'm not kidding. This one here, the really... looks like Lurch from the end. He is Giuliano della Rovere, the nephew of Pope Sixtus IV, and 30 years after this pope dies, he becomes the infamous Pope Julius II. If you saw Agony and Ecstasy about the Sistine Chapel ceiling, Rex Harrison played him in the movies. Not a nice person to meet in person, and certainly you wouldn't go down a dark alley with him. By the way, the word for nephew or grandson in the Renaissance is nipote, and giving them all this power, all these cushy jobs, became nepotismo. Nepotism, exactly. So this family pretty much institutionalized the nepotism in the Vatican for centuries. He, in 1475, commissions this building. This is a very rare shot of the Sistine Chapel from outdoors. To get the shot, you have to climb on top of the roof of St. Peter's Church. I know, because I took the photo. Now, there's a little-known fact about the Sistine Chapel. The Vatican doesn't like to admit it, but when people who have read my book ask them, after a little bit of pushing, they say, yeah, that's true, keep moving. The secret of the construction of the Sistine Chapel has to do with the city of Florence. Remember that Michelangelo was born in a little town right near Florence. Ruling as if it were their own little kingdom, the city of Florence, generations was the yesterday a series on the de Medicis. They were the wealthiest family in the entire Western world. So think of Bill Gates and Mark Zuckerberg and Warren Buffett, all in the same family, and you can vaguely approximate the wealth of the de Medici family. Now, they dealt a lot of their business was with banks, international banking, and the international wool trade. And Jews were heavily involved in both of these professions. And they were very, very friendly with the Jews. Up until this family, the Medici family, Jews were forbidden to live in the entire city of Florence. The grandfather, the patriarch of the family, brought in the Jews against the wishes of all the other noble families of Florence. They brought in the Jews, and Florence, surprise, surprise, blossomed. It flourished. The grandson, Lorenzo the Magnificent, Lorenzo de Medici, he started illegal studies in Florence. What do I mean illegal? All the things that the Inquisition forbade, they were doing behind the safe walls of their palace. It's like a fortress in the middle of Florence. For instance, you were not supposed to study Plato, only Aristotle. Aristotle had been Christianized, Plato was not, so the Inquisition said, can't read Plato. They were studying Plato in Florence. They also were studying ancient pagan Greek philosophers besides him, but also they were studying the Egyptian history, and most importantly, Judaism. They knew that Judaism was the root of their faith, and they wanted to know everything about Judaism. Now, back then, they were all trying to find the ancient mystical wisdom of the ancient world. They wanted to know Babylonian astrology and mysticism, Egyptian mysticism, Greek philosophy, and of course, Kabbalah. They had a problem. If you had a question, it was very hard to find a dead Babylonian or a mummified Egyptian you could have a conversation with. There were no more ancient Greek philosophers. Guess who was still around? The Jews. And since the patriarch of the family had brought Jews in, you had Jews and Christians studying together. Christians who were famished for information about Judaism. And this was completely illegal at the time. You could suffer the death penalty. It was called Judaization. It was doing good public relations for Judaism. Absolutely forbidden by the Inquisition, but done in Florence. So the architect who was hired to make the new chapel for the popes in guess what city he was from? Florence, Firenze, Baccio Pontelli. And he had been exposed to Jewish thought inside the palace of the Medici family. So he said, wow, this is going to be the most important commission of my entire career. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to do something that a Jewish architect can't do. This is, by the way, in the Talmud, in Tractate Megillah, it specifically says, if you're a Jew, you cannot make one kind of building. You cannot make a copy of the Beis HaMikdash, the Holy Temple, until we make it back on the Temple Mount, where it belongs. But you can't make, we can make 770s, thank goodness, all over the world. But we cannot make the Holy Temple. There is one full-size working copy of the Holy Temple of the Heichal, the central building, the first holy temple of King Solomon. There is one in the world you're looking at. The Sistine Chapel is a full-size replica of the first holy temple on the Temple Mount from Shlomo HaMelech. The decorations, very different. So this is the exact dimensions that you'll find in the Book of Kings. It's right there, and he followed them and made it. I'll show you how much he did in honor and respect for the Jewish tradition. This is a very, very rare woodcut of what it looked like when it was inaugurated in 1481. Now, the ceiling was exactly the same as ceilings you would see in synagogues all over Europe. A blue night sky with gold stars. The difference was, in synagogues, it would say what Jacob says, Zed Sha'al HaShemayim, this is the gate of heaven. They didn't put up the Hebrew message, but in all the major churches, they were copying the Jewish tradition and putting up the night sky full of stars. There's another reason it was popular. It was easy to do. Artists didn't have to schlep up the scaffolding and break their backs. You would have young kids, you'd give them blue paint, paint the ceiling blue, put up golden yellow stars, we're done. So this was really, to use technical language, the job for schleppers. So little kids with very rubbery bodies would climb on top of the scaffolding and paint it. You notice that all of the curved areas that are not flat surfaces, they left it blank because they felt nobody could paint anything decent on a curved surface. However, the floor has two different purposes. The floor shows the entire procession and activities for high mass in the chapel. The Pope would go disc to disc. On each disc, the choir, that's in the choir loft up here, would sing a different one of the psalms. Think of Shir HaMa'alot, the 15 Psalms of Ascent, and you've got that on the floor. Now, remember I told you this is the Heichal, the main building of the synagogue of Shlomo HaMelech. Now, what's in there? The Kodesh Kodeshim, the Holy of Holies. So one section, the altar section, back here behind this grill, or as I like to say, you all speak church Latin, right?
Sure.
In church Latin, this is called Mechitza. It's amazing. Everybody knew church Latin. Anyway, behind the Mechitza here is the Holy of Holies, the altar where the Pope would lead the services. To show us that it's the Holy of Holies, it's about 10 or 12 centimeters higher than the rest of the room. There's a step up here, and that floor is closer to heaven than the rest of the Sistine Chapel. It's the Kodesh Kodeshim, following all the dimensions, everything. There's even the Mechitza. And the floor, as I said, to dual purpose. It's the choreography or the flow of the high mass for the Pope, but at the same time, it is all the sphiabots, the spheres of the Kabbalistic Tree of Life. The entire floor is a visual meditation device for people who study Kabbalah. So you have the Pope's floor is a Kabbalistic meditational device. Now, this is just some of the stuff in the Sistine Chapel. At its inauguration, they hired the top fresco artists from Florence. There was one exception, one guy from the East Coast, but everybody else was a Florentine artist. Now, only about 2 years before they painted all of these frescoes on the sidewall, Pope Sistus IV had sent assassins to try to kill off the Medici family for all their open-minded liberal studies that they were doing in Florence, which was anathema to the church. Also because the Pope wanted to give the city of Florence to another one of his so-called nephews for his wedding or as a present. So the Medici family was in the way. They tried to eliminate them. It's like a mafia plot. Now, 2 years later, by the way, the attempt kills Lorenzo's brother, who was the most beloved person in Florence, and they slash Lorenzo's throat, but they immediately put some fabric on it, and they get him out of the way in a secret tunnel, and his life is saved. So 2 years later, he sends his best painters to decorate the chapel of the Pope that killed his brother. Why? They say it's a peace gesture between Florence and Rome, or between the de' Medicis and the Pope. It is complete. sabotage. And this is not even my finding entirely. Some of this had already been found by other historians, Catholic historians. All of these frescoes are filled with stuff. Now, by the way, I told you the floor, the Kabbalistic meditation device. This is one section of the floor of the Sistine Chapel. You can't see when you're there because there's thousands and thousands of tourist feet covering every inch of the floor. You have to be alone in the chapel at night and see all this stuff. This, by the way, is very rare. Photos are not allowed in San Sistine, but they did me the honor of having me go in and photo at night. It's very nice of them. This is exactly where they put the Scufetta, which is the portable furnace that burns the boats when they're boating in the conclave for the next boat. And you can even see scorch marks from embers, pieces of coal or wood, falling out of the stove over the centuries, burning the marble. Now, this is not in the time of the Renaissance, the Star of David. It's not known as that name yet. It's not known as the symbol of the Jewish people yet. It is the seal of Solomon. It is the key to Kabbalistic wisdom, to mystical spiritual wisdom. And as I told you, they couldn't find living ancient Greeks or Egyptians or Babylonians, but they found the Jews to study with. So they felt if you meditated long enough on a seal of Solomon, it would unlock all the mysterious mystical wisdom of the ancient world. So you'll see this in many, many churches because of their respect and awe for the Kabbalah. So this is telling us symbolically that the choice of the next pope is based on the mystical wisdom of the ancient world, symbolized by our Star of David. This is where the Pope, to this day, still kneels when he's doing a mass in the chapel. And he kneels on this very, very precious disc of royal purple porphyry marble, inside 10 sephirot. This is how the sephirot, or the spheres of the Tree of Life in Kabbalah, would be depicted in the 1400s. So he's kneeling in the middle of a Kabbalistic symbol before he enters his own sanctuary. By the way, this also proves that I'm not a professional photographer because I left my own backpack in the middle of the Now, this gray ramp here is covering the step up into the Kodesh Kodeshim, the Holy of Holies section. Why? Well, in 1555, a generation after Michelangelo repainted the ceiling, a very, very anti-Semitic pope took office. He was not only a monster to us, he was a monster to his own Catholics. Pope Paul IV. One of the first acts he did as pope was to walk into the papal chapel, take one look, and say, it's too Jewish, we gotta change this. So he ordered the Mechitza ripped up from its roots and moved a few meters east. So this is where the Mechitza is now. This is where it used to stand. You can even see some of the bolt holes that held it in place originally, because he didn't want the chapel to have exactly the same measurements as the Jewish Holy Temple. So even he knew it was a replica. Now, I told you that the side panels, a generation before Michelangelo, also have insults in them. Now, on one side, going left to right in Christian order, is the life of J.C. On the other side is the life of Moshe Rabbeinu, or Moses. And they twin events between the life of Moses and the life of the founder of Christianity to show the Jewish connection. They told the popes, don't worry, this shows that we have the new improved religion over the old one, but you know, this is what we came out of. Now, this, of course, course, the parting of the Red Sea. They made the Red Sea really red. And it says that there was an amud, a column, in the middle of the sea separating Pharaoh's army from the Jews. They put a Roman column mysteriously standing on top of the water right here. But the interesting part is hidden over here. Now, this is very small when you're in the chapel. First of all, we're talking, it's about 20 meters up in the air. And they didn't have eyeglasses back then. You had to be told in advance by other subversive people to look for the secret messages. So if you had been told in advance to look at the palace of the evil Pharaoh, you would know the secret. Pope Sixtus's family had their own family colors. Blue and gold, those were their colors. Blue and gold, that's the symbol of the Pope's family back then. So, over here is Moses and Aaron coming to tell the evil Pharaoh, Shalach et ami, let my people go. And here is the rest of the evil Pharaoh's palace. Let's zoom in a little bit. The Pope sitting on the floor, on the throne, is Pope Sixtus IV, with a beard stuck on him, wearing his family colors. So they're calling the Pope's family like evil pharaohs. And the royal palace of the Pope, of the Pharaoh, I mean, is the Sistine Chapel itself, getting destroyed when the waters are parted. And they're doing these zetzes, these insults, to the Pope and his family, and to Rome, all over the Sistine Chapel. Every panel has different insults. Now, so this tells us that there's a long history of hiding secret messages, either subversive or insulting, inside artworks. And they're doing this all over the place. Now, Michelangelo is a terrible student when he's a kid. I identify totally with Michelangelo. Any subject that bored him, he was incapable of learning. Latin, Greek, never learned them. He was even bad in his own language, in Italian. I've been lucky enough to hold private letters of Michelangelo in my hands. And in a few cases where he wrote them, it's like a slow 8-year-old wrote the letter. So for most of his life, once he could afford it, he had scribes, and he would dictate the letter, they'd fix the grammar, they'd make beautiful calligraphy, and then he would scrawl his name at the end. You can see it's a huge difference. His Hebrew calligraphy is much better. People are shocked when I talk about Michelangelo's Hebrew calligraphy. You like it? That's by Michelangelo. Michelangelo, his own hand. Now, the year is 1492, another year full of events. Besides Columbus, you know, discovering America, which is disputed, but back then, 1492, the ocean blue, we also had another event in 1492. When I talk to a Jewish crowd, everybody knows what it is. The Spanish Inquisition. Now, what they did is a death march. They started on the western part of Spain, and like a big broom swept across the entire peninsula, pushing all the Jews out of Spain. They arrived here. Thousands died on the march. And then they arrived over here, and then were scattered to the winds. Now, another thing in 1492, in Rome, they found a piece of what they believed back then was the titulus. That's Latin for placard or caption. In the Christian tradition, on a crucifix or a crucifixion scene, the Roman soldiers, to make fun of JC, they put a titulus, calling him the King of the Jews. And still, in churches all over the world, you'll see the inscription, Jesu, or here it is, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. And here it is in Latin. Now, in respect, was broken off on a rough diagonal right here after this mem of Mellon. So they only had this half, and they figured out how to do the other half. Now, every time I show this to an educated Jewish audience, they pick out what the so-called mistake right away. This is supposed to be Yeshu HaNotzri Melech HaYehudim. What's wrong with this picture? Me Yehudim. This is subversive back then. He is at 17 years old. Michelangelo is hiding his first political or religious or ethical protest inside his work for a major church in Florence. He's saying he wasn't the king of the Jews. He's saying a king from out of the Jewish people. If they had noticed it back then, he would have been the next barbecue in the middle of the piazza. But you know when the church found this out? When they read the book. Michelangelo was very good at hiding his stuff, but it was right there waiting for him. So, anyway, that's just the beginning of a very long career. Now, back then, in the life of Michelangelo, if you made it to 50, you were considered a medical marvel. Average lifespan was middle 30s. People died very young. He made it to almost 89.
Wow.
They thought he was a supernatural being. In his lifetime, they called him the Divine Michelangelo, Il Divino Michelangelo. Now, after making a name for himself in Florence, with many works, including the gigantic David, which you all have seen in photos or in real life, he is brought to Rome for a lot of different adventures, and he gets a lot of commissions there. But the Pope, remember I told you the nephew of Pope Sistus was Julius II? He's now on the throne, Pope Julius II. And he is told by his advisors to force this young sculptor from Florence, Michelangelo Buonarroti, to drop his chisel and pick up a paintbrush. Why? Michelangelo detested painting. He thought it was a second-rate art form compared to his beloved sculpture. He insulted painters. So he comes to Rome, he starts to get fame for his statues, especially the Pietà, which is still in the Vatican, and he makes a lot of enemies. So they all get together as a little conspiracy inside the Vatican. They go to Pope Julius II and they say, we know just the right guy to redo the ceiling on your uncle's chapel. The ceiling, after 30 years, the building had settled, it's very heavy, and the ceiling was caving in. They had to redo the entire ceiling and figured redoing it, we'll repaint it. So Michelangelo is being insulted in public. He's already considered an up-and-coming star in the world of art, and now they're telling him, paint the ceiling. Remember I told you that was for kids to do? Untalented gopher assistants? And now that's the job he has to do. When Michelangelo finishes this job, painting ceilings goes from being an insult to your talent to being the most sought-after kind of work. He changes the whole world of art. Now, on the ceiling, he's given this job. They assumed it would take him at least 10 years. So all his enemies felt this will keep him out of our hair for a decade. He did it in less than 4.5 years, instead of the projected 10 years. He practically lived up on the scaffolding. He slept up there, he ate up there, he worked all night. He worked himself to the bone, and he ruined his health for the rest of his very long life. He had scoliosis. He had breathing problems from all inhaling on the plaster. His vision went downhill from then on from too much plaster in his eyes. And his kidneys were ruined from squeezing on them. In the movie, everybody sees him on his back painting. That's incorrect. You want to see how he painted most of the ceiling? 4.5 years of doing this. Yeah. And so I can't do that for more than a minute because I redid the whole ceiling. It still is, by the way, in the Guinness Book of Records, the largest painting project in human history. If you think in meters, it is 1,200 square meters. In feet, that's 14,000 square feet. And he did it almost entirely alone. A lot of the details and decorations, he had buddies of his from Florence to do it. The Pope had given him an army of about 100 assistants to mix the paints and grind the colors, all of that. And he threw them out and locked the door on day one because he knew they were supposed to spy on him for any transgression, any blasphemy against the Inquisition. They were watching him. And he locked them out, brought in trusted friends, 5 of them from Florence, and they made the ceiling happen. Now, the very first thing that he ever paints up on the ceiling is this. Now, the original commission that he agreed to with the Pope was on the ceiling, on the four corners would be the writers of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That's traditional in Catholic symbolism that they're holding up the ceiling. The curved areas around were going to be the apostles. And then the ceiling, the middle part, was going to be just geometrical shapes with the crown and the royal seal of the Pope in the middle to show that he ruled the world. Pope Julius II ruled the world. That was supposed to be the whole thing. Michelangelo breaks the contract on day one. He makes a minor Jewish prophet. I'm not insulting Zechariah. He's in the book of the 12 minor prophets. Now, Michelangelo is afraid that after he's dead, they're going to rename all of his Jewish prophets on the ceiling as Saint so-and-so, Saint such-and-such. So he labels every single one in Latin to make sure that they will remain forever known as Jewish prophets. So he starts with Zechariah. Why Zechariah? There's many, many reasons, but one of them is he's the one that tells us to rebuild the Holy Temple. He's saying, I know what the room is. Now, how does he get away with it? Well, Zechariah is wearing the gold and the blue, the colors of the Pope's family. And this is an extremely handsome and over-retouched portrait of Pope Julius II himself. Julius II's nickname in Italian, while he was in office, was Il Papa Terribile, the frightening or the scary Pope. He would beat up people in public, bishops, cardinals, archbishops. He had a big staff to show he's the gentle shepherd, and he would beat the living daylights out of them in public. So this very flattering profile of the Pope, he climbs up, they pull him up to the scaffolding, take one look. He sees, well, wait a minute, you put me in the place of JC? I like it. Do whatever you want with the rest of it. I'm already happy. So Michelangelo schmoozed the Pope with a very flattering portrait. He used psychology. After that, the Pope said, whatever you want to do is fine. I'm satisfied. Now, this, of course, a secret within a secret. Remember I told you my background in sign language. Now, in most of the panels that Michelangelo paints, he's got these little baby-looking guys. They look like little cherubs, little angels. They're not. Their name in Italian is Punti, which just means little boyish figures. And consider usually just decoration. In every panel, they're telling you, if you know nonverbal communication, look over here. Don't look at the central thing. Look over here. Here's the secret. Look over here. So they're like directionals. So they're reading Zechariah's book of prophecy over his shoulder, like guys on the subway looking down to see the sports results in somebody's newspaper. But one is leaning on the other. I'm going to tell you another secret of Michelangelo. 17, he wants to become the greatest sculptor in history. He knows that he needs to know human anatomy. The ancient Greek sculptors, the ancient Roman sculptors, their sculptures are fantastic whenever they portray the human body, because they were allowed to dissect. On the Inquisition, you were not allowed to dissect bodies. Medicine and anatomy came to a screeching halt for 900 years, thanks to the Inquisition. But Michelangelo surreptitiously found a way to dissect in the mortuary for the unclaimed bodies of the poor. He bribed the monk who was in charge of the morgue of the paupers. So he knew anatomy. He was one of the top three people in his century for anatomy. He was a lousy student, but anything that really interested him, he would learn on his own and become one of the world's top experts. Poetry, optics, engineering, architecture, anatomy are some of the areas in which he was one of the top experts in the world, self-taught. I give him a lot of devote, a lot of honor. Anyway, since he's a master of anatomy, it looks like he's making a mistake here. Imagine I'm talking to the buddy and I have my arm on his shoulder like this. It's going to hang like this, isn't it? That's how a hand hangs. It doesn't make itself into a fist if you're leaning on somebody. But this little punto here is making a fist. Again, it's way up, it's a tiny detail. You have to be told to look for it, otherwise you'll never see it. But if you're told in advance and you have a good pair of binoculars, let's zoom in. Can you see it's made dark and blurry on purpose? His thumb is sticking through his hand like this. This is called giving the fig. Today we use another finger. Now, if you knew what this looked like today, I wouldn't show you the slide and the shoulder, but now it's no longer part of our culture. I can safely show it here. But this is more or less giving the finger to the Pope who's paying him to paint it. And he's showing how much he disliked the Pope and hated doing this job. He does it twice on the ceiling, and he does worse. In fact, I can't show him. But he does obscene insults to the Pope all over the ceiling. They had me debate this live on national television in Italy. With the Director General of the Vatican Museums and the Pope's official art historian, who was also German at that time. And so there was 2-1 live, and it still holds the record for the most watched live talk show in Italian TV history. They were out for blood. But I had read their books, they hadn't read mine. They didn't think it was worth reading. So at one point, said he's insulting the Pope all over the ceiling, and right over the papal throne, there's a giant caricature of the Pope, making him look like a poor jester, a jester out of control. And the head of the Vatican says, "And where did you see such nonsense?" And I point to the Pope's private art historian and said, "It's in his book, page 272. And the director looks at the Jesuit priest who had written the book on the 16th, who wants to crawl under any rock he can find. So, anyway, this is a, this is the original unretouched version. As I told you, a lot of things, for the sneer, for the dignity, we don't show in the synagogue, but this one, we couldn't avoid this. This is the number one most famous and important part of the ceiling, the creation of the first human being, Adam. Now, for centuries, there was a mystery about this. Everybody assumed that this part of the painting was not done by Michelangelo. Why? Michelangelo liked single figures that looked like statues. This changed art history. Instead of flat-looking painting, he made painting look like sculpture on the ceiling. It looks three-dimensional when you see the person. Now, here, he knows that Hashem can't touch Adam. He's creating him with words. But he's pointing towards Adam and giving him life. Now, they said it can't be by Michelangelo because you have this giant royal purple cape. Now remember, he is Christian. He will make images of God that a religious Jewish artist would never make. So he's allowed to do this in his religion. So he's showing the creator being held up in the air by angels. He said, wait, the creator of the universe needs to be held up by angels in the air, and he needs this royal purple cape around and this little blue-green schmata hanging down. Looks like the tail of a kite. It can't be Michelangelo. It's very busy. It doesn't make sense. Now, one of the first secrets found in this scheme was not by me. It's all the way back in 1975. An American surgeon, Frank Lynn Mershberger, from Indiana, walks in. He sees this. He says, oh my goodness, nobody's noticed this. I studied this first year of medical school. Ready? Cerebrum, cerebellum, occipital lobe, medulla, pituitary gland, and the brainstem that comes down to start the spinal cord. It is the perfect right section of the human brain. I mean, perfect. I've taken many neurosurgeons, world famous ones, through the Sistine. They take a look at this. They say, this should go in our textbooks. This is mamish perfect cross-section of the human brain. Why did he do that? Number one, to let people know he had illegally studied anatomy. Now, if you, sir, went to the authorities and said, do you know what he did on the ceiling? He did human anatomy on the ceiling. You know what their first question to you would be? How do you know? So everybody kept their mouth shut for so long a time, over the centuries, they forgot the secret. Now, in the morning, every religious Jew gets up and says the prayer for the functioning of the human body. Say, Baruch Hashem, Asher Yatzar et Adam b'chokhmah, who has designed or made the human being with divine wisdom, with chokhmah. There are very few things in the Jewish tradition they say that Hashem makes with chokhmah. There's the human body, there's the Mishkan, and the Holy Temple are all made with chokhmah. Now, here we have Hashem making Adam with chokhmah, with divine knowledge. Now, because he's from Florence, he'll mix in Greek philosophy with it. So this young woman over here is the Greek symbol of chokhmah, Sophia. So we've got Judaism, Christianity, and Greek philosophy all mixed together in the very same painting. Now, by the way, in Kabbalah, like reflexology of the feet, every sphere of Sephira, every one of the 10 aspects on the Kabbalistic tree of life, corresponds to a different part of the human body. Guess what the corresponding part of the human body is for the divine attribute of chokhmah? The right hemisphere of the human brain. Only somebody who had studied Kabbalah would know to show the right hemisphere of the human brain is creating Adam, is creating the human form. This is one of the many things that Michelangelo did to convince me I wasn't dreaming. Now, he's got 7 different Jewish prophets on the ceiling. Each one is more colossal and noble-looking than the next. Remember, in the 1400s and 1500s, any Christian painter depicting Jews would make horrible anti-Semitic caricatures, would not make us look noble, would not make us look intelligent, or even good. But Michelangelo does it all over the Sistine Chapel ceiling. Now, here, right over the Pope's throne, is the prophet Jeremiah, Yirmiyahu. Now, all the other prophets have bare feet because they're in the reproduction of the Holy Temple. Like Moses taking off his sandals, Hashem says, you're in a holy place, take off your shoes. With one exception, right over the head of Pope Julius II are a pair of really dirty, muddy boots to drop some mud right down on his canopy over his crown. His feet are crossed, which is another symbol of disrespect. He's showing his left or sinister side of his face. It's another thing that's not complimentary. And he's doing what is called the Harpocratic gesture. His lips are sealed. This is a mystical symbol back then in the Renaissance, showing you know mystical wisdom and you're not telling anyone. There's an old Kabbalistic proverb, which is, those who know, don't say. Those who say, don't know. So he's showing that he's not saying. What is he not saying? His eyes are the directional. Here we have another additional figure. He and Yirmiyahu, Jeremiah, are both looking at the same cloth. Now this is made with tondrui. It means looking three-dimensional, even though it's on a flat surface. It's a parchment scroll unrolling on the wall. To this day, 2017, you can open any of the official guidebooks from the Vatican to the Sistine, and they will say, at the end of painting, Michelangelo made the signature and the Greek letters Alpha Omega, Greek for beginning and end. Now there's a problem with this. First problem is, this is about half a year before Michelangelo finishes the ceiling. The other problem is, his name is nowhere on that parchment. There's a third problem. It's not Greek, it's Hebrew. It's right there in your face, Hebrew. Let's zoom in. He has Aleph and the actual Hebrew letter Ayin. Now in the entire Torah, you will never see these two letters together. They are the two silent letters. You will only see Aleph or Ayin, never together. Why does he put them together? There's many, many interpretations, both with Gematria and different Midrash. However, there's in the Talmud, and we know he must have studied this because his teacher, I'll get to his teachers in a second, his teacher translated a lot of Rashi commentary into Latin and Italian. Michelangelo, the Catholic artist, his teacher was absolutely obsessed with learning everything Jewish. It says in Rashi that, it's also in the Talmud, if you have a Kohen Gadol, a high priest, serving in the Holy Temple, if he cannot distinguish between an Aleph and an Ayin, he is not fit to set foot in the place. He puts this, oh, post. He puts this over the Pope's throne. That this high priest is not fit to serve in this Holy Temple. Again, the Vatican didn't know this until they read the book. Now, right next to Yirmiyahu, also over the throne of Pope Julius II, we have the ancestors, the Jewish ancestors, and one of them is Aminadab. Now, Aminadab is the father of Nachshon, the very brave, very faithful Jew who dives into the Red Sea to part the waters. Now, Aminadab is only mentioned about two times in the whole Torah. In commentaries, it said he must have been an amazing father to bring up a son so filled with passion and faith as Nachshon. His eyes are darkened from anger. We use this phrase a lot in the Psalms. His eyes are darkened with anger. I like him because he's a gingy. He's a redhead. But the other thing is, when they cleaned it in the year 1999, they were cleaning the whole chapel bit by bit. In 1999, near the end of all the cleaning, they got to Aminadab and they cleaned him up. They made one discovery that they knew about, one discovery they didn't know. They found this on his cloak. We need to know a bit of history going back many centuries before this was painted. In the year 800, 1978, a Muslim governor of the Muslim-occupied island of Sicily declared that Christians had to wear a carved wooden pig around their throats, and Jews had to wear the segno infamia, the sign of infamy. It was a yellow circle on their cloak. Why yellow? It is the symbol of dog urine. Oh. So Jewish men had to wear the yellow circle. Jewish women had to wear a yellow scarf on their heads, which was the sign of being a prostitute. That's the year 878 in Sicily. In the year 1215 in Rome, the Inquisition said, hey, what they used to do in Sicily, let's do it now again. So in 1215, the Fourth Lateran Council decided that the Jewish males, when they're in public, have to wear the yellow badge of shame. Guess who picks this up in the 1940s? Yep. This is the ancestor of the yellow badge of the Shoah. This was uncovered only in 1999, when they took off centuries of soot and dirt off the ceiling they found. That's the one they knew. What they didn't know was down here. Now, in European Sign Language and American and Canadian Sign Language, the sign for the devil or a demon or Satan, Satan, is very thick horns. These are the horns of the devil. So what does Michelangelo do? He has him point the devil horns straight down to the head of Pope Julius II on his throne. Let's zoom in and see. You having fun? And there we go. And again, this is just to show you an idea about who's pulling the strings. Michelangelo, I've said this in many interviews on Italian media, he's like somebody writing a message in a bottle and throwing it into the ocean. He's putting these symbols in, hoping somewhere down the line, there's going to be somebody who knows Judaic wisdom, Christian history, and nonverbal communication. So he was putting this, hiding it. His bottle happens to be the Sistine Chapel, but this message was there waiting for somebody to come in with a similar background to his. And it was just, I can say luck, but nothing's luck, nothing's a coincidence. It's all from above. Now, in all of Christian art throughout the Western world, there's many, many depictions of the plague of poisoned serpents in the wilderness. When the children of Israel go astray and they get a plague of poisoned serpents, who remembers what's the cure for this plague? The snake, the copper, nachash nachoshet, right? Now, in all the depictions, they decide Moses is an early Christian. And he sets up, for some reason, the rod of Moses happens to be a cross. Now, if you think it's silly, every single depiction of the plague of poisonous serpents, this is a very famous engraving by Gustave Doré, much, much after Michelangelo in the Sistine Chapel. All the depictions of the staff of Moses is a cross. There's only one exception in all of Western art history. Guess where? You got it. This is how Moses depicts it. There's no cross beams. It's just the staff of Moses with a copper serpent on it. That's it. Now, there are many other clues in the ceiling, but because it's the Michelangelo, because he loved the human body, they're naked in all of these panels. I wouldn't show it here. But another giveaway, of course, is the sin of Adam and Eve, Adam and Eve. What's the forbidden fruit? Apples. One person got to tell everybody. Figs. There's a whole makloch, and this whole discussion in the Talmud. Is it grain, wheat grain? Is it grapes? Is it grass? Is it this? That, and Hazal, the majority, decide, no, it's figs. another reason Michelangelo convinced me. Every single panel, I mean every single panel on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, Michelangelo had a choice. He was going to get the same bad paying either way. He was vastly underpaid for this. But he could do the safe Christian narrative, or he could do the very, very risky Jewish narrative. And every single time, on every inch of this 1,200 square meter painting, he always goes with a Jewish narrative, never with a Christian. Now, he finishes the Sistine Chapel, and he says, that's it. Thank goodness it's done. I'm never painting in that chapel again. Wrong. 22 years later, another pope from the de' Medici family, they knew each other as kids. They slept in the same bed. They ate at the same table. Becomes the pope, Pope Clement VII, de' Medici. He says, okay, you've done enough for the other fancy popes' families. Now for our family, the de' Medici family, you owe us the entire front wall of the Sistine Chapel. I want you to redo it and paint it. And don't do Jewish stuff like you did on the ceiling. On the front wall, I want the Christian story, I want the Last Judgment. And this is when JC comes back to earth, judges everybody, the good people go up to heaven, and the evil ones go down to Hoboken, New Jersey. Just want to see if you listen. Now, well, anyway, you see here, with this arm, he is lifting up the good souls up to heaven. Now, the best of the best souls are in a circle, an inner circle, right around him. Now, guess, according to the Inquisition, could have salvation and go up to heaven. Who can go up to heaven in the time of the Inquisition? Muslims? No. Protestants? No. Jews? Absolutely not. No way. Now, if you were going to go into the chapel after Michelangelo finished it, somebody from his underground subversive movement would go up to you, if you were part of the movement, say, you're going in, okay, listen. Front wall, Jesus is lifting up his right arm. He's pointing to an angel. The angel, will be able to spot the angel easily. The angel is all in red, bright red. Can't miss the angel in red. The angel in red is pointing to the really, really dangerous secret. Today, you go into the chapel or look at photos of the front wall, you will find out what Michelangelo's angel is pointing to. You see him pointing over here? Okay, let's see what the angel's bare arm. Everybody see it?
Yes.
Let's see what the angel's bare arm is pointing to. Whoa, we got two stowaways up in heaven. They're in the inner circle, right over JC's shoulder. We have the Jew of the West and the Jew of the East. Now, how do we know they're Jewish? Well, this is one way I was able to spot them, but I identify with them. But Jews in the Christian world, besides the yellow badge of shame, often had to wear a pointed hat so that the unlettered, ignorant masses would believe we were hiding devil horns. Anybody grow up hearing the Jews had horns? Remember that old? It was back then, and they made us wear hats that would reinforce that superstition. This is in Christendom, in the Western Christian world. Under the Muslims, the Jews under Muslim rule had to wear a yellow turban, the yellow turban of shame in the Muslim countries. So we have the Jew of the West and the Jew of the East in heaven. You know when the church found out this? When I had my debate live on TV, and I told them. So the person moderating the debate turned to the head of the Vatican Museum and said, wait a minute, 1,200 square meters? How many Christian symbols are up there? Mixed in Michelangelo's painting on the ceiling. Okay? Do you want to guess what percentage of the imagery is Christian? In the most Christian, important Christian chapel in the world, 70%, 50%, who wants to guess how much?
Whoa!
Not one. It is 100% Jewish. that's how the debate ended. When I discovered this, this was it. I said, I gotta go public with this. Now, how did the book get published? Well, the Pope made the shift. It was Pope John Paul II, who was a very, very good friend to the Jews. He grew up next to a shtetl in the middle of the woods in Poland. When he knew he was dying, he died of Parkinson's. And when he was at the point where he couldn't even talk properly, he had to have somebody stand next to him and repeat his words. He said, I don't want to die without getting the Levitical blessing in Hebrew from rabbis. He flew in at great expense, 160 of the world's top rabbis and cantors, and he wanted the Yivarecha, the three-part Hebrew prayer with their hands put on. And the last man to bless him was Rabbi Benjamin Bleff, the professor of Talmud and Kabbalah for Yeshiva University and now NYU. And when they were brought in, I was brought in by the Vatican itself to take them around. I was not going to tell anybody of my discoveries to the Sistine. I let the Vatican Catholic guide lead them around. We had a private viewing Sistine. They walked in immediately and said, wait a minute, this is our stuff. This is our stuff. Where's your stuff? This is our stuff. And they had a ton of questions. The Vatican guide couldn't answer any of them. They spotted things that the man working on decades had never noticed. And he said, boy, will you help? I said, sure. And I started, for the very first time, telling some of the secrets of the Sistine Chapel. They were blown away. They told Rabbi Bleff, who was not president at the time, he was meeting privately with the Pope. And the next day, we had dinner together, and he said, you know, I've written a few books. He was very modest. He's written over a dozen books, selling over 500,000 copies around the world. And we decided to write the book together. By the way, after he finished the Sistine Chapel, Michelangelo lived long enough, so long that he dealt with 11 different popes. And he fought with every single one of them. Near the end of his life, it was Pope Pius IV who wanted a new gate to the city of Rome built to his own glory. So it's called Porta Pia, which means the gate of Pope Pius IV. And this is the gate Michelangelo designed. Architects all over the world still admire it. They still come and sketch it. They're amazed by this. And they say, look at these designs. Nobody had ever done designs like this before. It's amazing. When Michelangelo built it, this middle part wasn't there. Just all of these little crenellations, these little trophies across the top. But he had this. Now, Pope Pius IV was brilliant, but very, very vain. He told everybody a lie. He said he came from a rich, noble family in the north. His father was so poor, he was a barber and couldn't afford a shop. He wandered up and down the streets with embassy man of La Mancha, where the barber has the beaten metal basin, and he could pull teeth or do surgery or shave your beard, anything for a penny, just to make some money, begging a business. And he'd have a towel draped over his arm. The Pope's father was an absolutely impoverished, struggling barber on the streets. That was what he covered up. He didn't want anybody to know that. So Michelangelo builds this beautiful gate in honor of Pope Pius IV. Now, I didn't discover this. The Vatican discovered this several years ago. These decorations are the beaten metal basin of a street barber and the towel draped over. So Pope Paul Pius IV is getting insulted by Michelangelo, who's in his 80s at this point and still zetsing the popes. Now, the game still goes on down through centuries. In the 1800s, a modern age architect was asked to put this part, a high part on it, to make it, they thought, more impressive. So he did it, but he knew by people passing down the secrets mouth to mouth, or orally down to the centuries, he knew Michelangelo's insult. So he said, okay, you know what I'll do? I will make the same basin and towel, but I'll put a block of soap in the middle for lathering up the beards. So that's still there, and there's many stories I could tell you about this, but let's go on. Okay, I told you about the book. Now, Michelangelo dies in the year 1564, very advanced old age. He burns all his private notes because he knows how dangerous they are. He does a lot of covering up. He doesn't want his friends to get in trouble in the Inquisition. He was in three different subversive groups over his long lifetime, and he was always the last man standing. All his friends and comrades were captured by the Inquisition, starved to death, sent in exile, or burned in public. He was the only survivor. In every architectural project he made, this is a secret bunker in which he would hide if necessary. He did have to hide in one in Florence, and I've been down in there. It's closed to the public, but it's amazing. It's covered with graffiti, almost all of it by Michelangelo himself while he's down there hiding for weeks. The book came out. The Vatican immediately told the thousands of people who work inside the Vatican's walls every day, don't read that book. So the day it came out in Italian, guess what they all did? Day one of sales in Italy, 20,000 copies flew off the shelves. It's in its 15th or 16th edition. As Tommy was telling you, it's now used by all the guys in the Vatican. Whether they hate it or love it, they have to know it because everybody's asking about the Sistine Secrets. It came out here, since I'm in Montreal. This sold out in France, by the way. Italian, of course. Japanese. This is the Portuguese language one. There's two versions. South Korea. Best sold in South Korea because anything with Talmud, the South Koreans love it. Russian. And even Polish, but many, many different languages as well. When Michelangelo dies, they try to bury him in Rome as a Roman. He's a Florentine. The Romans and the Florentines hated each other's guts back then. Think of Los Angeles and New York, or Sydney and Melbourne, two cities, completely different personalities, dumped CIA, Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. So, when he was buried in Rome, the Romans had a collection. I mean, the Florentines, they had a big collection. They got a lot of contributions, and they hired the two best burglars in all of Florence, second story thieves. And they sent them in an ox cart to steal Michelangelo's body. And they stole it in the middle of the night. They disguised him as a pile of schmatas, covered in rags, in an ox cart. Got out the city gate and hightailed it back to Florence, where they buried him at dawn the next day as a proud Florentine citizen. He's still there in the Church of Santa Croce, which is like Westminster Abbey of Italy. Now, that church, Santa Croce, in spite of it being so important, when they were finishing the church, they ran out of money and they never made the facade, the front of the building. Raw brick for centuries. Finally, in the late 1800s, they had a competition to put a new marble, beautiful front on the front of this very, very important church in the middle of Florence. Anyone who's anyone in Italian history, Galileo, Leonardo da Vinci, Marconi, everybody, are either buried there or they have a memorial. So Michelangelo's buried right in the middle of it. Now, remember his protests against the persecution of the Jews, his love of the Jewish tradition, his love of the Jewish people. What would happen with his final resting place? The competition to put the facade on the church where he's buried was won by a Jew, Niccolò Matas, born on the east coast of Italy, but from a Hungarian family originally. He won the competition. And he made the facade, beautiful white marble facade. He said, giant Magenta V open entrance. And this is, again, not in human hands. This just happened. But it's a perfect, perfect fitting. This is what Michelangelo was trying to do. In our book, Rabbi Blunt and I say that besides his protests against the corruption of the use of power and the intolerance of the Vatican in his day, he was planting seeds that would someday, hopefully, come to fruition of interreligious, not tolerance, but actual brotherhood. We're still working on it. I'm still involved with Jewish-Christian relations, both in Italy and in Israel. And we're hoping that his message from 500 years ago will really bear fruit in our day. I'll finish up, I know I'm over time. These people have been so attentive, I couldn't resist. These are just some of the different documentaries and lectures around the world. This is the organization that I founded. It's still operating in Poland and Italy. And other books about secrets in Italian art and history. But everybody asks me when I do Q&A about the Vatican, guess what they want to know about the Vatican? Where's our stone? Where's the menorah? Here's the one on the Arch of Titus. Now we know there's a debate about the branches, straight or curved. Well, as we say in Talmud, there's not a difficulty. The original one with the straight branches is made by none other than Moses. We know for a fact that that is cut to bits by Nebuchadnezzar when he takes all the Kalim to Babylon. Now, this is one of the many copies of the menorah made for the second temple. This is a copy that the Romans take with them back to Rome, triumph. But everybody wants to know where's our stuff in the Vatican. I'm not going to talk too much about this, but when I'm on the media, I just say no comment. In the year 2002, this design was found, and it is a secret menorah from the time of the Inquisition, where you would insert the seven branches here. And this is not my theory. This is upheld by all art historians. This is the menorah designed by Michelangelo. And again, only discovered 15 years ago. Now, this is an illustration inside the Vatican walls by the great painter Raphael, and who knew nothing of Yiddishkeit, but he did somehow know how to make a proper representation of a menorah in the Holy Temple. But this is the best part of the story. People wanted to know if people are still hiding secrets today. This secret is only 20 years old, from 1997. This is an old photo of the Parliament of Italy, made by the great artist Bernini, artist and architect. This is the parliamentary house. Here's the semicircular room where they all sit. Eat up all our tax money. Now, the piazza in front was really ugly. There were garbage bins, the parking spots. It was an eyesore. And they had a competition in 1997 to redo the piazza facing the parliament. It was won by an architect named Zuccotti, and he loved to research and find hidden symbols and put them in his work. So he decided he should illuminate the horrible government in it. We have a terrible government. Mussolini said it is not impossible. It is not difficult to govern the Italians. It's impossible. And it was one of the few things he was right about. Anyway, it was redone according to the artist's specification, the architect's specifications in 1997. This beautiful obelisk stolen by Augustus Caesar from the Egyptians in the year 31 before the Common Era. It was a sun clock, and there's the original gnomon or pointer put back in, right in front of the front door of the Parliament. And there's the timeline, the shadow of the needle, very simple, very clean, got a lot of awards, everybody loved it. I went into this five-star hotel right here on the edge. You see that?
Yeah.
And I went in and I said, I'd like to go up on the roof. And they said, are you Professor Dahlberg? We see him on the media all the time on TV. I said, guilty. He said, our hotel has a secret? I said, you better believe it. They said, they got on the loudspeaker, they said, attention staff, you all have a break right now. We're all going up on the roof with the professor doctor. So I had the whole staff up there. These people had worked with it for years. They didn't know this. When you're on the roof of this hotel, you'll see the secret that the architect built in. He wanted to illuminate the Italian politician. Talked about chokhmah, divine wisdom, before. The flames of the menorah, especially the central one, symbolize chokhmah, divine wisdom. So he doesn't have the cups on the outside. He's putting the light of divine wisdom inside the building. You can talk to any Italian, show them this, they'll say, it ain't worked yet. But it's the only parliament in the world with a giant menorah embedded into its entrance. Those are just some of the secrets. I want to thank you so much for your attention.
Clearly, my
Nigel's waiting hundreds of years for Roy to come along. David, he's not going to reveal his secrets. So, Yasha Kweya, may you merit the combination of all this very soon. And,
Michelangelo's depiction of Moses, Moshe Rabbeinu, with